Welcome to the CMA Theater. My name is Peter Cooper. Hold your applause. And I'm a writer and editor here at the Country Music Hall of Fame and Museum, the coolest building in the world. Today, the coolest building in the world is cooler for the presence of Ronnie Milsap. He is the piano playing, country soul singing, braille reading, radio listening, native North Carolinian, and 42-year Nashvillian who is, along with Mack Wiseman and Hank Cochran, among the three newest members of the Country Music Hall of Fame. He is also the subject of a brand new museum exhibit called Ronnie Milsap, A Legend in My Time, which opened yesterday and runs through the end of August, and it is spectacular. And you got to see the suits. You got to see the suits. Before Ronnie comes out to talk with us, I need to talk with you about a couple of concerns. We do not anticipate any kind of emergency situation in here, but if one arises, leave the building immediately. Go away just like you came in, but faster. Also, what we have over the next hour or so is the opportunity to hear Ronnie Milsap tell stories from his remarkable and unprecedented life. He is here in this moment to do that, so let's please stay in this moment with him and without our cell phones. Please turn them off. If you have to keep them on, put them in airplane mode or silent mode or any mode that avoids noise and distraction and eye rolls and angry glares from otherwise kind people around you. Now that all that is taken care of, let's turn our attention to Ronnie Milsap, who could have been bitter, could have been small-minded, could have been an angry person. He was born without sight, without comfort, without much. He was abandoned by his mother when he was too young to know that he was abandoned. He was sent away from the Western North Carolina home he shared with his beloved grandparents, Homer and Phenia, and educated in Raleigh at the State School for the Blind. At that school, he was praised and he was humiliated. His talents were sometimes celebrated, but he was a nonconformist whose unceasing creativity did not sit well with all. One of his teachers actually struck him in the face. Ronnie Milsap knew hardship and cruelty, isolation and indignity, and in the wake of it all, he made a decision. He chose positivity and humanity and empathy. He decided to share, to connect, to laugh, to smile, and to sing. Ronnie Milsap sang 12 number one country songs. Wait, no, that was just in the 70s. He sang 12 number ones in the first 5 years of his career, and then the 80s happened. He sang 35 number one Billboard country singles. Between June, yeah, that's... Between June of 1973 and March of 1992, every song he released was a top 20 country hit. All but two were top 10, all but six were top five. But all that stuff is really for the scoreboard. Ronnie Milsap isn't great because of his hits. He's a hit because he's great, and he's great because he chose to be what Country Music Hall of Fame and Museum Director Kyle Young calls one of the most upbeat human beings on Earth, leading me to wonder if there are other more upbeat human beings on other planets. But I doubt it. Ronnie Milsap's life is defined, enriched, and illuminated by love, by his love of music, his love of radio. He still listens every night to Eddie Stubbs' show on WSM AM 650. And also by his love of his family and his sweetheart wife of 49 and a half years, Joyce Milsap. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to our stage Country Music Hall of Famer, Ronnie Milsap. Ronnie, they're standing for you. Haven't even done anything yet.
Hey, well, thank you so much, Peter. And thank you, folks. It's a real honor to be here today.
Well, we're going to get into it today, aren't we?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. Now, I want to talk about I've been to your house, Ronnie. It's a pretty nice place here in Nashville. There might be room for me to move in, even.
Yeah, that's right. Anytime.
Thank you. It is a little different than the photos I've seen of your boyhood home in Robbinsville, North Carolina.
Oh yeah.
Tell me how that was.
Well, that was a very humble cabin. I grew up with my grandparents. And, you know, it was a very loving environment. My grandmother cooked that great breakfast every morning. Only thing that comes close to that is Cracker Barrel.
Your grandmother, Phenia.
She
was something.
Very loving person.
Now, you were with your grandparents because your mother actually left you when you were very young. She viewed your blindness as a punishment from God.
Yes.
When you were 1 year old, you went to live with Phenia and Homer.
I did.
And were they like parents to you?
Yes. Yes, they were. My grandmother, Phenia, was just like my mother. I called her mother.
And you...
And Homer Frisbee was one tough character.
He was
very loving man.
Yeah, they were great to you, and you needed someone to be great for you at that point. Did they explain to you about your mother?
Yeah, they did explain to me about my mother. And
did you have a great bitterness about that?
I don't know. You know, I've tried to think about it later on in life, and I never hated my mother anyway. I don't hate anybody. Don't know how to do that. I think love is what gets us all through.
You, how old were you when you were sent to the Governor Moorhead School for the Blind, Ronnie, in Raleigh, North Carolina?
I was 6 years old. I remember Homer Frisbee teaching me how to count from 1 to 100 by fives, by tens, by 20, you know, the whole thing. And I went to the Governor Moorhead School. I enrolled there, the State School for the Blind, as it was called then. I enrolled there September the 6th, 1949. So I was 6 years old.
Wow. And you had very positive and very negative experiences at that school. You had some professors who were, some teachers who were very helpful and aided you and your creativity. You studied classical music there?
Yes, I loved that. That was great. I remember meeting a person on that first day, and he was my best friend all the way through high school, named Larry Atwell. And it's a shame he passed away when he was like 22 years old, and I miss him to this day.
You also met a fellow at that school named Jay Spell.
Oh.
Who turned out to be one of the great keyboard players to come through this town, was a member of the O'Kanes hit group in the 1980s, and fabulous accordion player as well. Did you realize how good he was early on?
Yes, I did. He was just amazing. He was amazing then, and he was amazing later on in life, and he played on a whole lot of the records that I made over at Ground Star Studio. Jay Spell, one of the best of all time.
Tell us a little bit, please, about the, as we say, not all of your experiences there at the school were positive, and you actually were someone struck you at the school.
Yeah, I was in study hall sitting typing my assignments, and a house parent, we had house mothers, house fathers, he knocked, one of our friends was partially sighted, and he hit him and knocked the glasses off his face and broke his glasses. And I questioned him. I said, "You should not have done that." So he proceeds to slap me in the face. And I had some light vision at that time. I could tell when the light was on and when it was off. But after he struck me, I never had that light vision anymore. I remember standing in the bathroom and turning the light on and off, and I couldn't tell the difference. And eventually, in February 1958, they had to remove that eye in the infirmary at the State School for the Blind. And I'd say probably a pretty lonely time around there.
Was music a lifeline for you?
Oh, yeah. Always has been. Love music, and even as a child, I could hear songs on the radio and mimic those songs. You know, sound just like Ernest Tubb or Red Foley. You know, I love doing that. And then I started studying music at the State School for the Blind. I started violin at 7, piano at 8. And of course, I learned Braille when I was 6 years old. And mostly that school was very positive for me. You know, and eventually I wanted to go and become a professional musician, but all my counselors at school said that I'd fail. You shouldn't do that. You will fail. You'll wind up out on the street. You won't be able to get a good job and all that.
Told you would be a drag on the state. that you would lose. You'd become somebody that would have to be on welfare or something. And
they were afraid of that, and they said, not only that, you will embarrass all of us at the state of North Carolina.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I didn't want to do that.
So you decided to be a lawyer.
Yeah, well, I wanted to do something academically. Only thing I could do was go to junior college at Young Harris, over in Young Harris, Georgia. Yeah, and I remember being there, and the class that I absolutely just couldn't wait to get to was in political science with Zell Miller. Boy, what a great teacher he was.
Became governor later on and a very good friend of yours.
Yeah, he sure did. He's done real well in the state of Georgia.
Now,
I thought, you know, when I was in his class, I thought, You know, actually studying political science would be fun. But I started playing in a band and all that, and I decided, well, maybe this is a lot more fun. Yeah.
You started making your way to Atlanta.
Yeah.
And hanging out at the Peacock Club, rough and rowdy R&B
I love that. Got to see all the great R&B stars of the day. Shake hands with Jackie Wilson and Marvin Gaye. Little Stevie Wonder, when he was 13, met him.
Did you interact with these folks much?
Yeah, a little bit. You know, I remember talking with Benny King, who had out a big record at that time called I Who Have Nothing. And I just thought he was so good. And I was so enthralled by being around him, he called me on stage to sing with him. And I did that. Quite often I'd sing at the Royal Peacock.
You came to the attention of the Crazy Cajun, Huey Moe.
I sure did.
The record producer from Texas.
Record producer and a friend of mine also at WQXI, a guy named Patrick Aloysius Hughes. I used to go in and sit in on his air shift, WQXI in Atlanta. Just being around him and being around the records, being around the music, always excited me.
And you got to make music through Huey Moe. In the 60s, you put out an album. It comes out, unfortunately, the week after President John F. Kennedy was assassinated, tragically.
Yes.
And the record, do you remember the title of the record?
Yeah, the A-side was Total Disaster. The flip side was called It Went to Your Head. So try to get that played on the radio. You can't do it.
So that did not turn out to be a commercial breakthrough. You did, though, people were writing about that record and about you, and you wound up getting a name change out of it. To that point, you had been Ronnie Milsaps with two L's and an S.
Yeah.
And somebody misspelled it, and you just went with the misspelling?
Yeah, they started running it all over the state of Georgia in an article. M-I-L-S-A-P, and I said, that's my new name. So I went legally, had it changed to that.
You met in 1964 Joyce Reeves.
Yes,
who would become Joyce Millsap, one L, no S.
Yeah.
Or no, well, only one S. You were studying at the time in school. Did she try to talk you out of going into the music business and into a future as a lawyer? How did she feel about you playing music?
Oh, she was very supportive of my playing music. And, you know, she loved music so much it inspired me. And she thought that I ought to pursue music. And I did, all around Atlanta.
And then beyond Atlanta, you signed a deal in 65 with Scepter Records, a New York-based recording company.
Yes.
And put out a debut single that is, it was an R&B hit, produced and written by Ashford and Simpson.
Boy, what great writers they were.
Can we hear a little bit of that, Ronnie?
Yeah.
Okay, let's.
Never had it so good. Never had it so good.
brother, you better hang on. Could I leave my baby? No, I don't think I could, 'cause I never had it so good. No, no,
never had it so good before.
Well,
that's good.
Peter, it was a top five soul record. First time I showed up on Billboard.
Yeah. Did you think you were going to remain a soul singer?
Yeah, I did.
Maybe you did.
Didn't I sound a lot like Jared Butler on that?
Yeah. How about that? You mentioned that ability to mimic.
Yeah.
You had early on. Not a lot of people can do Ernest Tubb and Jerry Butler. Never Had It So Good made an impression, and you made an impression. Last year, as you were being inducted into the Country Music Hall of Fame, Sam Moore from Sam and Dave came out and started telling stories about when you were on your first tours behind Never Had It So Good.
Yeah.
And here's what Sam said. He said to everybody, he said, "I know you're wondering why I'm up here. Back in 1965, there was Sam and Dave, and we were playing a club, a theater in Washington, D.C., Black Theater. So what I did, I'd never seen this man, but I'd heard the song Never Had It So Good. I thought it was Ray Charles at first. To make a long story short, I was coming to rehearsal. I was going across the stage, and I saw this lady with this guy. I said, 'How you doing?' I ran back to the other side. I said, 'Dave, he's a white boy in a colored theater. He ain't gonna make it.' And Dave didn't believe me, so he went over on the other side, and he came back, and he said, 'Oh, shit.' Now, you got to understand, this is in a predominantly black part of Washington. This white boy, first of all, he's blind, his wife is white, and he's getting ready to go up there to sing, opening for Sam and Dave. So Sam thought it was going to be a disaster, and he says, he went on, and when he got through with our butt, when he got through singing, I had sloshed in my shoe, and I couldn't find Dave." Do you remember those touring days, and did you feel like a fish out of water?
No, I felt really good about all that. And Joycey and I had just gotten married, and we were in a dressing room right next to Sam and Dave. And we kept hearing things that they would say, and it was the most ungodly thing that we'd ever heard. But I loved, you know, having a chance to play the Howard Theater in Washington, D.C. Got to meet a lot of people there. When I was an R&B singer, maybe that, as an artist, that didn't last as long as I thought it might. But I will say, my wife has always been the brains behind everything that I've done. Yeah. She's a beautiful lady, and we lived in Atlanta, and Chip Smallman, a record producer in Memphis, wanted me to move to Memphis, so Joycey and I moved to Memphis.
He promised that you would get a gig at TJ's nightclub, and that he would record you. Chip Smallman had that American Studios there, and he was recording some cat named Elvis Presley.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He sure was. And I got to play on Kentucky Rain with Elvis. Yeah. Boy, what a great thing. Mm-hmm. And get to meet Elvis Presley. He was the voice of my generation. And there was a time in my life that I could sound just like him.
He loved your singing. You sang on Kentucky Rain as well.
Yeah.
And then he started booking you for gigs.
Yeah.
Elvis Presley would have these parties, and he would hire Ronnie Milsap to play piano and sing. What kind of guy was he?
Huh?
What kind of guy was Elvis?
Oh, I thought he was just phenomenal. Of course, I always loved Elvis so much. And I remember at a New Year's Eve party at TJ's, I worked up enough nerve to say, Elvis, you want to sit in with us tonight? We know all your songs. Elvis said, no, I just want to be here with my friends and enjoy this evening. And I said, well, that's fine. But I was hoping to play some of those early Elvis records because I know all the songs. I used to sing them when I was younger. And having the chance to sit and talk with Elvis about how he did certain things in the studio and what he did on tour. And how did he meet Priscilla? And, you know, all the fun things that you want to ask Elvis, I got to ask him a lot of those things and be around him. And I thought it was just wonderful to be around Elvis, of course.
You also, in that era, met a fellow named Ray Charles.
I sure did. I actually had met Ray Charles when I was trying to figure out, do I want to be a professional musician? I played some songs for Ray, and he said, if you live and breathe music every day, if that's what you're doing, then yes, you ought to become a professional musician. I went back and told my counselors in high school, Ray Charles says it's okay if I become a professional musician. And they said, well, if that's what you're going to do, you just better be careful because you'll fail.
Well, let's see some. We've got a little bit of video footage of the failures that you and Ray Charles became. Later, you're playing for President Ronald Reagan in Washington, D.C. Let's run this clip of you and Ray, and you're introducing the segment as well.
That's great.
Here they are, and I'd like to make them welcome, please, Ray Charles and Ronnie Milsap.
Is that Roy Milsap? Yeah. I love you for sure.
Thank you, Mr. Acuff. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to say just a few words about this man sitting over here next to me. You are sitting next to me, aren't you, Ray?
I bet it's all right, Dave.
I want to thank him tonight not only for his monumental contribution to country music, but also for his specific contribution to me as a personal inspiration. Ray, it doesn't matter that I've never seen you. I know you're beautiful.
Oh, Ronnie, thank you very much, Ronnie. You're beautiful yourself.
Thanks a lot, partner. And right now, we're going to perform a couple of hits that we've had by a very talented singer and songwriter named Don Gibson, a longtime member of the Songwriters Hall of Fame. In fact, it was Ray's version of a Don Gibson song that was responsible for bringing country music to a whole new audience that's still with us today. So here's our Don Gibson medley. And just to show you what pros we are, we're going to do it without sheet music or cue cards. I do believe we are.
Everybody's going out and having fun. I'm just a fool for staying home and having none. I can't get over how she set me free. Oh, lonesome me. I bet she's none like me. She's out and fancy free, flirting with the boys with all her charms.
Yeah. All right. But I still love love her so. And Ronnie, don't you know, I'd welcome the girl right back here in my arms. There must be some way I can lose these lonesome blues.
Forget about the past and find somebody new. I thought of everything from A to Z. Oh, lonesome me.
All right. That was 1983. Now, wow. When you're singing duets with somebody like Ray or Kenny Rogers, do you feel any sense of competition in doing that? Are you trying to best them or blend?
Well, I don't want to compete with anybody, but you do. I mean, you're singing with Ray Charles. You better come up off of it. 'Cause he's good. My wife was there that day, and Joycey said, are you going to be as good as Ray is going to be? I said, I hope so. I want you to tell me if I'm not. And she told me I was. Yeah.
Now, Ronnie, we're going to get into some dates that are really close together as your career quickly slides into, as your life quickly slides into a career. October 16, 1972, you were checking out the CMA Awards on TV. And Charlie Pride won the Male Vocalist of the Year Award. And you begin wondering about Nashville and about country music as a viable option for you. Do you remember that night?
I do. Sitting at a house in Memphis. I do, and I saw that, and I thought, more than that, my wife, Joycey, started thinking about Nashville.
The brains.
Yeah, exactly. And she said, we need to move to Nashville. I said, well, how are we going to do that? I don't have a job there. But I wound up playing for a week at a little club called The Villa, right down there near the Anchor Hotel. And a guy came in and said, my name's Don Davis, and I want you to play the King of the Road Hotel. They had a showroom on the ninth floor at the King of the Road.
King of the Road is down there near LP Field now. It wasn't near LP Field then. There was no such thing as an LP Field. but it's this, you can see it from the highway. It's a funny-shaped hotel. It's got this strange-looking addition on the roof, and that was where you played.
Yeah.
Yeah. Showroom there. And you were offered a chance to come and make more money for playing fewer nights a week than it teaches.
Yeah, exactly. And all of a sudden, I said, Joycey, I got a job. So we moved to Nashville.
Yeah. I believe you said you'd celebrated Christmas in Georgia and then headed up through Chattanooga and up that way in Nashville on December the 26th of 1972.
Yeah.
You and Joyce and baby Todd Millsap.
Yeah.
And you had a gig that night. That was your first night in Nashville. Got on that stage and sang. Do you remember what you sang? I do.
You do?
Uh-huh.
What was that?
Sunshine go away today. Jonathan Edwards song. I don't feel much like dancing. What was the King of the Road like for you?
Did you love
it from that first night?
Yeah, it was just electric. There was a whole lot of people that showed up. And I had a good band with me. We rehearsed during the day and played at night. We didn't have to play but five nights a week. We all got paid really well for that. And it wasn't long before Tom Collins and Jack Johnson were up there at the King of the Road, and Jack Johnson said, "I want to manage you." Well, he was Charlie Pride's manager. So I wound up over at Jack's office and signed a contract with him. January the 3rd, 1973.
So you'd been in town a week, and now you had a management contract with Charlie Pride's manager.
Yeah.
You've got Tom Collins working with you, and you are all the rage in Nashville. You are the person that the entertainment industry is coming down to the King of the Road to be entertained by Ronnie Milsap.
They did that. Seemed like they had finished work and they'd all show up down at the King of the Road.
Yeah. And I was looking for photos of King of the Road and wasn't able to find a whole lot. And I called Tom Collins and asked him why I didn't seem to be able to find any photos. And he explained to me that a lot of the people that were at the King of the Road weren't necessarily there with people that they wanted to be photographed with.
That's true.
But all of a sudden, you got Barbara Mandrell coming in there. You've got studio musicians. I believe Charlie Rich.
Yeah.
Came along one night. He sat in, right?
He did sit in with the band. Hey, you mind if a poor boy sits in with the band? I said, "You want to play piano, Charlie?" Or he said, "No, you play piano." I said, "Okay, what do you want to sing? Behind closed doors?" Yeah. So we did that. And he's standing with the mic in his hand, and all of a sudden, he falls on the stage. It sounded like a dynamite went off, like a tree had fallen. His head wound up in the kick drum, and we were playing Superstition. That song is real famous from Stevie Wonder. We had to roll him off stage. Left him sitting there in the chair. Everybody went home.
Farron Young would come by?
Oh, love Farron
Young. And you used to identify him from the crowd, right?
Yeah. I said, "Farron, I love that blue jacket you got on." "I told you that son of a bitch wasn't blind."
So January 3rd, 1973, you signed this management contract, and does Jack Johnson assure you that he can bring you fame and fortune as a country singer?
No. He said, "I gotta tell you, I can't make you a star. You'll have to do that yourself." I said, "Damn, Jack, why'd I just sign this contract? I thought you were gonna make me a star." He said, "You'll find out what I'm talking about." And I did. But he financed the demos that I recorded over at Jack Clement's studio.
March 12th, 1973.
How about that, Peter?
You go in to Jack Clement Recording Studios on Belmont Boulevard with a bunch of A-list players.
Yeah.
Lloyd Green, Charlie McCoy.
Yep.
And recorded three songs. "That Girl That Waits on Tables," "All Together Now," "Let's Fall Apart," and one called "I Hate You."
Yeah.
Were you nervous that day? Did you walk into that studio thinking, "I'm going to change my life with this day in the studio"?
I remember going, it was a Monday because I had Monday off. And I went in the studio, and Jack Johnson had told me that all these are the A session players in Nashville. And I had met Pig Robbins before, but I was happy that he was on the session because he's the best session piano player in town. Charlie McCoy was leader on the session. And he was playing organ on that stuff. And I said, is that what you're going to play? He said, I just played it on Easy Loving for Freddie Hart. Well, I said, oh, well, let's go.
Charlie can play anything with or without strings, it seems like.
Yes, he can. He's just a fantastic musician.
Let's hear what it sounded like that day. Your day off from the King of the Road, Monday, March 12, 1973. Let's hear a little bit of a song called I Hate You.
I try to hate you right out of my mind.
I hate you. Oh, how I try to hate you. I get bitter every time you run through my mind. Between love and hate, there's a little thin line. And I'm trying to hate you right out of my mind.
Well, there you sound like Ronnie Milsap. All of a sudden, you were out of the mimicry and imitation business and had become the wholly actuated Ronnie Milsap right there. Did you go in consciously going, I want to try to sing hard country? Or
no, I listened to the radio every night. And I knew pretty much when I came to Nashville, I wanted to be a country singer. I mean, it was a dream. And to actually make that come true was way beyond what I could imagine. I just couldn't believe it. This first record happens. All of a sudden, I'm going on shows with Charlie Pride, and it was just an amazing career.
There were other people who didn't believe you could do it, and one of them was the guy who wound up signing you to RCA. Jerry Bradley had heard you sing before and thought you were great, but he thought you were a rock and roll singer.
Yeah, he thought I was a rock and roll singer, a blues singer.
So you take those three songs from that, what seemed like a demo session that day.
Yeah.
Down to Jerry, and what's his response?
He said, you know that some bitch can sing country.
So it was March, you record that, March 12, I believe, and in April of 73, you sign an exclusive recording contract with RCA Records. RCA releases that song, I Hate You, it climbs into the top 10 of the country charts, and you get the green light to go in and cut seven more sides to create your Where My Heart Is album.
Yeah.
Production cost on that album, by the way, $8,500, which is what it cost for 20 minutes in the studio now.
Yeah, you're right.
What was it like for you to have that album, Where My Heart Is, out on the market?
I got to tell you, it was really exciting when Jerry Bradley came over to Tom Collins' office and said, I want you to go in and cut seven more songs. And I cut those songs in RCA Studio B, which is very few things that I've recorded in Studio B. But we found some good ones.
Yeah, it worked out.
And had that first album out, and Tom Collins was always hearing me say in interviews that country music was where my heart is. And Tom said, that's the name of the album, Where My Heart Is. I said, yeah, okay, well, let's do that. And then Jerry Bradley came over and said, we're going to press 40,000 records. And I thought, oh, no, we'll never sell that. But we did.
You did. It did well. And then in January of 74, you went out as the opening act for Charlie Pride.
Yeah.
April of 74, 12 days after Hank Aaron broke Babe Ruth's all-time home run record, RCA releases an Eddie Rabbit penned song called Pure Love.
Oh.
Became your first number one.
Yeah, it was my first number one.
Did you know it had that kind of potential?
Well, I hoped it would. I remember recording it in RCA Studio A on January the 8th, 1973. Cut two songs that day that were big songs for me. Cut Pure Love and cut Please Don't Tell Me How the Story Ends, both on Elvis's birthday.
Wow. When you went on tour with Charlie Pride, your best friend and the guy who had your back on tour was a drummer, Steve Hawk Holt. Played drums in your band in Nashville, became kind of a tour manager for that tour.
Yeah.
You were a blind man touring the still racially challenged South with an Afro-wearing black man as your guide, opening shows for the first African-American singing superstar in country music. How was the tour? What did you learn from Charlie Pride? What was that experience?
Oh, goodness. Sit on the wings of the stage and listen to Charlie Pride. The way he paced his show. And I'd ask him certain nights, would he include a certain song? Drive the crystal chandeliers or whatever. He said, you like that? And I said, yeah. But Charlie Pride was, he's a real class guy. He really is. And someone I dearly love, and he gave me a tremendous amount of help in the beginning. I mean, how do you get out and play for thousands of people all at once? Find yourself on the Charlie Pride show, and that'll do it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That was a hot tour, and it put you in front of so many people. October 10th, 1974, so less than 2 years after you'd moved to town, you won your first CMA award, and it wasn't for a horizon kind of rising artist thing. It was for the best male vocalist in country music. Do you remember that night?
I do, and it was hard to believe when they called my name. I didn't know what to do. I remember Tom and Jack Johnson came over there and made me get up, led me up to the stage, and I accepted the award. I actually walked off the stage, and who had the award was Jerry Reed. And he handed it to me, and I said, well, that is really great to be able to be in Nashville and win the Male Vocalist of the Year award. I mean, it was stunning, Peter. It was just beyond belief.
So less than 2 years after moving to Nashville, that happened. It all happened so quickly after years of things not happening at all, but very slowly. By now, you're a couple of singles into what would be an astonishing run of 48 consecutive Billboard Top 10 country singles.
Yeah.
Now, through 1976, most of those were pretty traditional in sound. A lot of steel guitar and country-fied arrangements. And then in 77, you hit with a ballad that y'all may have heard called It Was Almost Like a Song. A 3 week number one with a pretty sophisticated string arrangement, and that was the beginning of Ronnie Milsap's sonic experimentation. Did you catch any guff from country purists or people who thought you were leaning too much towards pop?
I don't know. I just remember Cam Mullins, who had done the strings on For the Good Times for Ray Price. He did the strings on It Was Almost Like a Song. And eventually, a gentleman named Joe Galati would tell me, that's what you need to do. You need to become a multi-format artist. Then you can cut anything. And I started to believe that.
How'd that work out?
Of course, that whole thing eventually, you know, some disc jockeys got to saying, well, that Almost Like a Song trend is over, and Ronnie needs to get back to recording country music. And I heard that, and I didn't want to disappoint anybody. And I kept trying to come up with great country songs. By then, I had my own recording studio, and stumbled into a writer that really changed my life, a guy named Mike Reed. Mike Reed was All-American for Penn State, and he played professional football for the Cincinnati Bengals. He comes to town, and he's a classically trained pianist and a hit songwriter. Yes, he is. And I started recording his songs. Then all of a sudden, one day, I stumbled onto this song called Stranger in My House. Good Lord. I couldn't believe it. And Jerry Bradley had just stepped down in 1983. He had stepped down from president of RCA and turned that over to Joe Galati. And Joe Galati said he was going to put out Stranger in My House as a single. Well, it got a lot of resistance at radio because of the guitar solo. Sounded a lot like Led Zeppelin to somebody. And, you know, so some stations refused to go on it. But I sit in the conference room at RCA and call radio stations and try to convince them to play Stranger in My House. But it turned out to be my biggest international record. That thing was number one for 13 weeks in a row in Australia. Could not believe it.
You used that studio, Groundstar Laboratories, to... you were there a lot. The soundboard... they had a Braille soundboard, a portion of which we have in the exhibit here at the museum. And you were bent on some experimentation. Probably the most famous synthesizer solo in country music history is Any Day Now. Was it long hours for you? Did you enjoy the studio part, or was that just the stuff that you had to do before you got back out on the road?
I love the studio. I love that whole thing of making records. And I wanted my own studio, and this guy came in and named Rudy Brewer, and he had built in Los Angeles, he had built Fleetwood Mac's new studio. And we had him as the consultant to build Groundstar, and he did it right on budget, right on time. I was just thrilled to death getting in the studio and having my own place to work. And there were many nights I would stay up all night long with Rob Galbraith. He and I were in publishing together. We started doing records together. And I'd stay up all night with him, and we'd make records. And some of them turned out to be really good.
Yeah, 24 of them that decade went to number one, Ronnie. So now, when you're on a run like that, and that is one of the most remarkable runs that this music has seen, does the pressure get higher, or does it feel, do you feel at ease because you've done so well, or do you feel like, how am I going to top that? Is that a nerve-wracking experience? I've never had this particular experience, so I'm asking you.
Oh, Peter, I'm very thankful for all the people who have helped me over the years, and there have been many, many of them. And most of all, I thank my wife, Joyce, because she's kind of orchestrated everything that's happened.
She would tell you when she liked or didn't like a song, right?
Yeah. I brought the mix for Lost in the 50s home, and she kind of liked it. But she said something was missing in it. Can't you go into the end and do a high note? I said, yeah. So I called the studio manager and said I needed the studio next morning. And they were saying, we can't do that because Jimmy Bowen's in the studio tomorrow. I said, well, just tell him I only need like 10 minutes. So they let me in. And then I had to get to my next show date. Only way I could do that was get a Learjet, $10,000 for a Learjet to get me there. So that high note cost me 10 grand.
Which might be worth it because you got 2 Grammys for it. So that's five grand per Grammy.
It's definitely worth it. And definitely thanks to Joycey for pouring that out, because she knows what is commercial and what's not.
Ronnie, some people kind of, they look at the changes in your sound starting in 77, and well, after that it was more pop-leaning, but you actually, your final hit of the 1980s was a Stone country song called Don't You Ever Get Tired of Hurting Me that was written by your fellow Hall of Fame inductee, Hank Cochran. That song was recorded by Ray Price and George Jones and Willie Nelson, but Hank told you that your version was his favorite interpretation.
He did. He told me that. I'm thankful for that.
Did you, when you would cut a Stone Cold country song like that, was it as a response to criticism that you'd been going too pop, or was it because that's the root of the whole thing for you?
It is the root of the whole thing for me. And I love to get hung up in a real good country song. I remember in the studio one day, and I cut, You Took Her Off My Hands. Now please take her off my mind. And Tom Collins said, man, when you sing country like that, you go to a place that nobody knows where you are. And I do. I kind of get lost emotionally in all of that. And I love singing country. I ask you, Peter, I don't know if the fans like that or not, because I don't know if you can sell a country album today, can you? Yeah? Well, that's good to know. I'd love to cut another one.
Yeah.
And I will. Yeah.
And you love not only to sing a country song, but you love to listen. One thing that impresses me about you is that you have remained a fan. You never got to disliking music or feeling that it was a job to listen. And you really do listen to Stubbs every night and sit there and cry at George Jones songs.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's something. Now, while you have that love for old-style country music, classic country music, you also are a prime influence on new century country music makers. I mean, you got this kid, Hunter Hayes. He was born in September of 1991, a few months before your last Top 10 hit, Turn the Radio On. And yet he has been irrevocably and absolutely influenced by your music, but plenty of others have as well. Are you surprised that these songs and these recordings continue to find favor in the new century?
Oh, I'm very happy and satisfied that artists like what I've done, and Hunter Hayes is a very sweet man. Keith Urban, a very sweet man. He was talking one time about a Jim Reeves tribute album I did one time called Out Where the Bright Lights Are Glowing for RCA. And he said that was the only record they kept on their turntable. And that really knocked me out. Appreciate that.
That was recorded at Woodland Studios over in East
it
Nashville.
It sure was.
And I believe you told me once that was maybe your favorite album.
My favorite album that I did for RCA. Yeah. Yeah, it is. You know what would have been fun if I could have gone in and actually put my voice with Jim Reeves' voice on some of those things. That would have been good. Because eventually, Peter, who was it, Deborah Allen that did that?
That's correct.
Yeah.
Jim Reeves, a pretty indelible influence on you.
Yeah.
Do you remember hearing him when you were younger? How did Jim Reeves' voice come into your life?
Well, I heard it on the old Philco radio. Am I losing you? I said, God, what a singer. What a voice. And I had a real nice jumbo Gibson guitar, and I hit that A chord, and I started singing that myself. Am I losing you? I didn't know I was going to have a hit on that someday. What a thrill.
Your resume of hit recordings that we've talked about today and the awards that you've won, gosh, you won 3 CMA awards in 1 year at some point. It seemed to make you what a lot of people felt like was a slam dunk for membership in the Country Music Hall of Fame. Yet you told me in recent years that you worried that you would never be inducted. Why was that, and what was the feeling like when you got the notice that you were going into the Hall of Fame?
Well, I know that in 1977, when I won Entertainer of the Year, I was talking to Jerry Bradley at RCA. I said, Jerry, I mean, I've won that. Where else is there to go? And Jerry Bradley said, one day you're going to be in the Country Music Hall of Fame. I said, you think so? And he said, yeah, I do. I said, well, how do I get there? He said, just keep doing what you're doing, and you'll get there. And he was right. Yeah.
Was it something that you were very aware of? Were you concerned about not getting in?
Why, yeah. Because if I was telling my wife, I said, it might be the year, because I'd been in the running a couple of other times. And when Tom Collins and the ladies from the CMA came over to the house and said I was going to be inducted in 2014, I could not believe it. I was so happy.
And, you know, you haven't come all that far. We're not on a nice day like this. You can walk to the King of the Road motel from here. You mentioned that Joyce, and you call her Joycey, has been by your side the whole time. What would your career look like without her?
Oh, it'd be nothing. I would be nothing without her. I heard about a song yesterday. I guess I'm running over new things that I want to record with Catherine Marks, a pianist, a good friend of mine that plays on every session that I do. Some song she was talking about yesterday. How do you take care of a woman? Love her, and love her. That's how you take care of a woman. And that's what I try to do with my wife, Joycey. She's a real treasure, I'm telling you. Very pretty lady, too.
You were told that when you were at Young Harris, and she made a campus visit, and one of your professors said, "Hey, Ronnie, you may not know this, but she's a looker."
Yeah, he did. He said, "You're going to keep seeing her?" I said, "As long as I can."
Coming on now 50 years.
Yeah.
When you reflect on this life and this music that you've made, music that has accompanied you throughout this journey, does the journey seem as amazing to you as it does to us, you know, from Robbinsville to this stage?
Well, it's amazing to have grown up the way that I did over in Graham County, North Carolina, going through this life and being here at the Country Music Hall of Fame. I mean, a lot of people may wonder, what else do I want to do? Well, I want to keep doing a lot of what I've been doing. Yeah, that's what I want to do. Keep making hit records, and I've fortunate to have a very strong, smart personal manager in Bert Stein. So we're going to keep moving together until we get everything done that we want to do. Yeah.
Ronnie, thank you so much. It's such a pleasure to talk with you about this incredible life that you've lived, and thank you for the music you've given us, and thank you for coming here today and sharing with us.
Peter Cooper, you are a true friend, and it's always an honor to be around you.
Thank you, Ronnie. Hey. Ladies and gentlemen, Ronnie Milsap.
Hey.